Welcome you, and we thank you for being here. I mean, Felix was an amazing person. He touched our lives, he made us laugh, he made us drink coffee. He was an amazing person. I respect him like a father, and I will do my best not to cry. I'll be honest with you. Will you please join me in prayer? Bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for who you are, Lord. Thank you for giving us love. Thank you for loving us, Father. Thank you for giving us Felix, Lord. We gather here today, Lord, to remember him, Lord. And we thank you because you're the God of all comfort, grace, and peace. Father, we pray for strength and help in our time of need. Help this amazing family to come closer together and find strength from each other as they're united in their love for Felix. Give us truth today as we face the reality of death and grow in our knowledge of you. Thank you for your unending love for us, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name. We all said, Amen. Amen. We gather here today to honor the memory of Felix. We also gather to comfort his family with our words and our presence. And we desire to hear what God will say through his holy word by the realities of life, death, and eternal life through his son Jesus Christ. Psalm 46:1 says, God is our refuge and strength, our ever-present help in time of need. Isaiah 41:10 says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not dismay, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Who was Felix? Felix was an amazing person. He born on March 3rd, 1940 in Puerto Rico. He was 82. March 3rd, 1940, yeah. He was 82 when he went home to be with the Lord on February 6th of this month. His parents were Juan and Panchi. He was a widow. His children were Kevin, Bruce, Cindy, Philip, and Rose. Grandchildren, Christopher, Brenda, Susan, Eric, Cheyenne, Philip, Desiree, and Daniel. Other survivors, many brothers, family, and great-grandchildren. Felix was an occupational, was a supervisor of West Melbourne Parks and Recreation. He was a member of the King of Columbus. He was a caregiver for the church landscaping. He volunteered for many years and gave us a great example of love and service. He enjoyed gardening, we all know that. He loved plants. He talked to people through plants, going to church, spend time with his family. He was a family man. I can tell you that for sure. He loved to eat. Know that. He loved to socialize with friends. He had a great sense of humor. I remember that. He loved to share the gospel, the good news of the Lord. He enjoyed a good cup of coffee. I'll tell you that. I remember him came to my home, helped me best control or with plants. And I offered him coffee, and he said, do you want coffee? I said, you don't say offer if you don't want to give it. So yes, give me coffee. Give me Bustelo. I love that strong coffee. I love too. You can cut him, and it will be out of his veins. That's just a joke. Special memories, how much he loved going on mission trips. Also, many trips with his family to Puerto Rico. He had a lot of beautiful memories. Things that make it special. I was thinking about that. There's so many that make him special. One that described him so vivid in my heart and the minds of a lot of you here, he will take his shirt off and his shoes and give it to anybody else. He was that kind of man. His qualities were strong character, a fighter, a generous person, a great example to others, not only in faith but in character, a hard worker, honest, he was funny, he was an encourager, he was a loving person, joyful, and much, much more. He was a strong and faithful Christian, and his life demonstrated his love for God and for others. He was a man of faith, a prayer warrior, a mission-minded Christian, always ready to go, a believer with passion to share the gospel. He loved the Word of God. His favorite Bible scripture was Psalm 23. I remember one is, He restores my soul, Psalm 23:3. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Now we will have some people sharing special memories. We'll have his brother, Bruce.
His son.
His son. No, I'm sorry. My bad. Changing names.
Yeah, that's okay. That's
okay. Well, I know I'm not going to be as strong as you are, so I'm just going to get my tissues out now. I'm going to tell you all a little bit about the Felix that you don't know. Okay? You all think you know him, but there's a whole lot more to this man. Okay? When he was born in Humacao, Puerto Rico, he lived in a very rural area. We would call it hillbilly today. And he only had eighth grade education. I don't know if anybody in this room knew that, but he only had eighth grade education. At the young age of about 11 or 12, he left school. And he went to work in the sugarcane fields, and he would carry bags of fertilizer up the hill to the sugarcane mill all day long. That was where his birth certificate got changed. Did you know he had a changed birth certificate? Well, the foreman on the job, to make him old enough, changed his birth certificate by a little bit, and he was a little older than what he was supposed to be for many, many years. It wasn't until the rule came out that you had to have an updated birth certificate in Puerto Rico that he found out how old he really was. Now, having only an 8th grade education and not having very good diction or speech patterns, when he came to Florida back in 56, he didn't speak any English and he had to learn the language. And if any of you have ever seen any of his writing, you'll see that he referred to things like, you know, I need four shovels full of dirt, S-H-U-B-B-E-L, okay, instead of an S-H-O-B-E-L, it was a shovel. He would use colloquialisms in a way that they didn't really quite go together. Like he would say about something like, what in tarnation? Well, he would say, what in the intarnation? You know, so he had an unusual way of speech, okay? But he did have a way with speech. And I've always contemplated the fact that, you know, the Irish say that when you go to Ireland, you have to go to Blarney Castle and you have to kiss the Blarney Stone. It's supposed to give you the gift of gab. I think he took a bite out of it. Because there's nobody in this room who can say that man didn't talk to them and it didn't reach into their heart somewhere, okay? Of my four siblings, my brother Phil inherited his strong work ethic and his do anything. I can fix anything, I can make anything. My brother Kevin inherited the ability to, he always was willing to go out and help somebody who needed help. You needed a hand, you call Kevin. He didn't matter what he was doing, how many things he had planned, he'd jump up and help you. My sister Cindy, she had her thing where she would always, you know, somebody who she needed somebody at the last minute to come and help with something, she was always there. Me, I got the gift of his mouth. When he came to the States, he did go to try to get his GED, and he did study for many years. He never did quite accomplish that. He started out as a laborer with the city of Melbourne, digging ditches, pushing a lawnmower, swinging a machete, trimming weeds and bushes back. And from there, he worked his way up to where he became the supervisor of Parks and Recreation. Very prestigious position, which he held for quite a few years. He had the ear of many a city manager. When he would need something or have something to do, he could just somehow appear as the guy was getting ready to go to lunch and just be kind of in his way. So he would stop and talk to him for a couple minutes. And then Dad would present his idea, and then, oh, come on back, let's talk about it, you know. So he would often get things done without having made an appointment or gotten in to see the man. The mission trips, towards the end of his life, the mission trips became his biggest joy. And when he went to Colombia a couple of times, he went to Guatemala. He went there one time when the volcano was going off, and it almost killed him because, you know, they were inhaling all that volcanic ash, and it's like glass. And he came back, and it really took him way down. We weren't sure he was going to make another trip. But he did finally get to go to Israel, which was the highlight, the pinnacle of everything he had ever done with Calvary Chapel. He brought home some rocks for me, because when I was a kid, he pushed me very, very forward into the Catholic Church there, and you know, I was an altar server, and I was the acolyte for the priest. I did a lot of things there, and he had hoped that maybe someday I'd grow up to be a priest. Sorry to disappoint you, Dad. This trip, when he went over there, he went to the places that we had all read about in the Bible. He went to the Garden of Gethsemane. He went to the Mount of Olives. He went to Beatitude Hill. He went to Masada. And he brought me home a rock from each one of those places that was labeled. And he brought them home to me because he knew I would appreciate what they were. Well, I brought the rocks back and I had to put them in with his ashes to be interred, because it was something that was very important to him. He was actually baptized in the Jordan River. I called it Jordan Ditch because if you look at the pictures, it's not much bigger than a canal, a drainage canal around here. And the water looks pretty much the same color. So he was pretty brave to have done that. But that trip meant more to him than anything, and it was the last real trip that he went on. Because after that, his health started to fail. And as time went on, now he could... Anytime Felix walked into a room, you know, and there's nobody in this room who can deny this. When he walked into a room, doesn't matter what the event was, Felix took it over. Okay? He would walk in that room in a few minutes, he's given orders and commands and move this over there and pick that up and go get some more punch or whatever. It didn't matter what it was, he took charge. So when Sergeant Felix was there, everybody got busy. Because of that, his presence is going to be extremely missed, because all these events now are going to have to find new leaders. We're going to have to find new people to step in there and be the person in charge, the person who's giving the orders and the commands. I think the church is in great hands. I think they'll be able to do that, but they're not going to be able to do it with just one person. Okay? You're going to have several people to replace him. Not bad for a man who just barely made it out of eighth grade, don't you think? There are, to honor, remember a man is to honor him. And we're here to remember him today. And I look around the room here and I know that there must be several hundred memories that you all can share with each other. And I encourage you to share them, because as time goes on, we don't share these memories so much anymore, and we tend to forget about all the wonderful things that a particular person has done. So make sure you share the memories. Make sure you keep them alive. Make sure you keep the memory of him alive. And I'm going to turn it back over now before I lose it.
Thank you.
Well, see not to stop. I need a few words.
Hi, some of you know me, some of you don't. I'm from Calvary Chapel. I was the daughter that Felix always said that he didn't have with Rose. We adopted each other when I lost my father in 2017. We met in 2014. He became a counselor to me, a father figure, one that always saw me around the church, and if I was distressed or under stress or overstressed, he would come and put his arm around me and tell me, let's talk. And yes, like Ramon said, over a cup of coffee. Always. Fond memories that I have of him. Like a father, he was awesome. Like a friend, like no other. He loved Fred and Ethel's meatloaf. We used to hang out there at lunchtime. His favorite dessert was the tiramisu from Olive Garden. He always, when he tasted that dessert, he would go, mmm. That was his favorite dessert. We shared a lot about the Lord. He was the one who invited me to come and join him after Rose passed, to help him out over at the gardening areas in church. And we started coming into the gardens at on Saturdays and started recruiting people. And maybe some of you were volunteers once. It was awesome the way just to see him love on the gardens and show us how to maintain them and how to take care of them. He would teach us the names of the plants. What were they good for? What were they not good for? He was always like, yes, the commanding officer. He will be terribly missed, but we all know where he's at.
Amen.
He's in a better place, no pain, no sorrow. He is with Rose, with his mom, with all those who passed beyond him. And I just want the siblings to know, Bruce, Cindy, Kevin, Felix, he always, always, always spoke about you to me. Always, always loved you. And I want to share that with you, to tell you that he loved you beyond anything. Okay, you were always in his mind, always in his prayers, always in his heart. He was truly a family man. He wanted to represent what manhood and fatherhood was, really. He didn't want to follow in his father's footsteps. Unfortunately, his father didn't follow the Lord, and his father was another type of man. But his mother taught him to be and to be who he was, and then to encourage him to follow God. And that he shared with me. And just remember that all you men there, be godly men. Okay, remember that of Felix. Hold on to that treasure that he taught you. One funny thing he used to share with me, and I'll end with this. He would give massages to the different pastors in church. And we would go at lunchtime, and he would share those little things with me. He would share that so-and-so screamed like a girl. I would laugh. And every time when I went back to church and saw the pastor from afar, I would crack up laughing. But I knew the pastors that are here and whoever he gave a massage to, that was a loving massage from the Father. And as he massaged you, he was praying over you. Okay? And he had this wonderful God-given gift of healing in his hands as well. And just let's remember him, let's celebrate him, okay? Whenever you see the oak trees around the parks here in Melbourne, Felix was behind each one of those oak trees. Just remember those parks. Whenever you go there and visit them, he was behind it, okay? He was behind everything that was done in the different parks. He lives in our hearts, he lives in our minds, but most of all, he's with our God.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sina. I'm going to ask Pastor Dave, one of the days we have at church, he's got a letter to a few words for us.
In some ways, this is fitting because Pastor Dave Folkerts, I'm not him, by the way, but he's one of Felix's best friends, and I was also one of Felix's very close friends. But Dave and Barb, I were on vacation, it was already scheduled. Normally he would probably be doing this, sorry Ramone, not you, because he had officiated many other things for the family. So he sent a letter instead, and since I call myself at Calvary the other Dave, it's kind of ironic, Dave is reading Dave's letter. And I would echo a lot of what was already said about his brother said. Felix was very smart. I don't care what kind of school he had. He was a genius in many ways. A genius. And we'll talk more about those massage stories in a minute, too. After I read Dave's letter. Here's what Dave Folkerts had to say. To the family and friends of Felix Rodriguez from Pastor Dave Folkerts and Barb. I so wish I could be here for the celebration of Felix's life, but my wife and I are on a pre-planned vacation for our 40th anniversary. Like I said, I think they're on a cruise right now. Felix was like another dad to me, kind of what Zena said. I first met Felix in 2000, and when he asked me to be his best man at a small wedding to Rose in February of 2002. Felix and I had a similar love of landscaping and growing flowers and trees. Over the years, Felix gave me many cuttings from plants to grow in my yard. It was a special time a few years ago when I invited Felix over. We walked around my yard and looked at all the plants that are still growing, and they're still growing now, by the way. And Felix got to advise him, give him more like, cut this, do this, trim that, kind of what his brother said. He would take over the room and tell Dave, the gardener, what to do. In a loving way, though. If any of us ever had a plant question, Felix was the one we went to for an answer. For many years, Felix was a faithful leader of our church's landscape ministry. He led and organized many other volunteers, always ensuring the church grounds looked beautiful. He also planted plants found in the Bible and developed like a printed tour where you can take this tour, go see these plants that grew in the Bible. And those are still there, by the way. Felix loved the Lord Jesus and served him every opportunity he could. He traveled with me and many others on medical mission trips to various places like Guatemala and Colombia. He shared the gospel of Jesus with a love for people and a listening ear. He also made sure our entire team had back and neck massages after a day of carrying heavy loads. There were many times Felix would generously give of his time and talent to work on my own back and shoulders if I was in pain. I would greatly enjoy our long talks even more than the massage. Felix knew so much about so many things. He was always encouraging me in my pastoral calling, especially during the tough times of ministry. Felix will be greatly missed by so many people. I am so glad to have known Felix, and I have great comfort knowing he is tending the gardens of heaven right now. I will spend eternity with him someday, and so will you if you follow Jesus. I am now praying for all of Felix's family and friends to be comforted by our great God during this time of saying, so long, just for now. Because we will see him again. Ramon will talk about that, I'm sure, in a few minutes. So that was Dave's letter. Let me add my Dave's 2 cents to that. I consider Felix not just a co-worker in Christ or a church member. We don't really have membership, but he was a good friend of mine. I took numerous mission trips. I was sitting over there trying to think, at least six, maybe more, Guatemala multiple times, Panama, Colombia. Ramon was on quite a few of those. Some people in this room are on some of those. He loved the Lord, and he was always willing to serve. No matter what was needed, he would step in or maybe advise us where to step in. But he was awesome. I was part of his massage ministry, by the way. He called it his ministry. And it's okay to laugh. I think Felix would want us to laugh today, by the way, because it's a celebration of his life. He's not gone. He's just moved on to a better place that we'll see him again. But he would come to my office, and before I had an office, we would find different rooms around the church and try to hide, and, you know, he wanted you to take your shirt off so we'd have to make sure no ladies walked in. But he would tell me some of those same stories that Zena talked about, people yelling and screaming, because I think even Ramon might call it the ministry of pain. That's all I'm saying. Many people thought it was. I see Gary back there. Gary's another. The ministry of pain. But I would tell these guys, no pain, no gain. Because if you had a knot, you just wake up with those knots on your shoulder, Felix's hands could get that out like nobody else. And I've been to professionals that couldn't do near the job Felix could do. But as Dave said in that letter, we would talk, we would laugh, we would talk about Bible stuff, maybe the weekend or the Wednesday night sermon. We'd also have a great time. And, you know, I'll tell you one little tiny funny story. And I could tell, I don't know how many, I could be up here all day telling stories about Felix. He's such a great guy. We laughed one time, and, you know, he says, I'm a good example of one of the Bible verses. And I said, which one, Felix? He said, you know, when the Pharisees tried to trick Jesus. And I'm like, which? And I kind of knew what he was heading, but I wanted to let him tell me. He said, well, I've had a few wives. And remember the Pharisees asked Jesus, who are you going to be married to in heaven? Well, Jesus answered, nobody. There is no marriage in heaven. So Felix is up in heaven right now with all the ones that have passed, like Zena talked about. Everybody's getting along. We're all going to see each other. The real important thing to do, though, is make sure we're not just believing in Jesus. Felix would tell you it's more than that. It's following Jesus. Following Jesus, putting him as the center of your life. And that's not why we want to go to heaven, but seeing Felix will be like a bonus, I think, after we get there. So remember all the great memories you had, the fun stuff, the bad stuff, even the sad stuff like today. It's okay to be sad, but just think about where he is. He's literally in the garden of heaven. And we taught a book, Genesis, this past Wednesday. We talked about the tree of life. Felix is at literally the tree of life right now. And it says the fruit and the leaves are for healing. And remember, Adam and Eve couldn't go there because they said, if you eat of this tree, you'll live forever. Felix is living forever with Jesus, waiting on us.
Thank you, Dave. Anybody wants to share something small? Family? If you're comfortable now? Okay. So we hear great stories and memories and testimony of who was Felix. Describing, to be honest with you, it should be impossible because he was a great man. No perfect, nobody's perfect. We don't say he's perfect, but he was a great man. He loved the Lord, he loved people. I'm sure that when Felix arrived to heaven, he heard those words that every Christian longs to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. And I bet he's one of those persons in charge of the gardens.
He's already taken.
No, he's, correction, that's his son. My bad. That's his son, that's my fault. Come and share your master's happiness. Matthew 25:21. Felix's action spoke volumes of his love for Jesus, for his family, and for others. Today we pause to remember Felix. You are here today because in some way he touched your life. I encourage you to hold fast those special memories. Cherish the past moments, the blessings and the laughters, the joys and the celebrations, the sorrow and the tears. They all add up a treasure fund of memories that you share together, and it will keep him and your thoughts and your spirit. Today I'd like to share with you a little message, three keys about the gospel, about the love that God has for you. And Felix was a man of the word of God. He loved to share the gospel. I see him loving people through the Bible so many times in mission trips and in the church, even myself. He corrected me a few times. He encouraged me. They give me pow pow, like we say it in other words. So the first key I want to share with you, that we cannot escape that. You see, all of us last week have different appointments. Maybe a doctor appointment, maybe a family, maybe a business appointment. But one appointment that Felix kept is one he received Jesus as his Lord and Savior. It's interesting that in the Bible talks about this one appointment that we all have in common. Hebrews 9:27 says, just as man is destined to die once, after that to face judgment. See, death is an appointment that all of us, no matter who you are, we keep. All of us one day are going to die. Or if the Lord comes before that, you will be taken with him. In the book of Ecclesiastes, we can read that King Solomon, who was known as the wisest man, and there it said, there is a time to live, and there is a time to die. But for the Christian, there is no fear in keeping this appointment. 1 Corinthians 15:55-57 says, O death, what is your victory? O death, what is your sting? For sin is a sting that results in death, and the love gives sin his power. How we thank God, who give us victory over sin and death through Jesus Christ our Lord. Know this. Jesus Christ, death, burial, and resurrection, destroy the power of sin and death over us. There's no death for the Christian. Second key I want to share this morning is that that is not the end. You see, in all the Eastern religions, mostly all in the world, some people strongly assume that that is the end. They think that when they go to the grave, that's it, all's all over. So what they say is, bring a party, do whatever you want in the world, because this is it, you have nothing else. Okay? And the second, they believe they will be reincarnated. You will come back again and again till you get it right. You will do it right, you will do a good person, you have a moral good life, and then God will say, because you did good, more good things than bad, no problem, you can come to heaven. But that's not true. But questions about life and death are not new. In the oldest book in the Bible, Job asked God this very question. He said, Job 14:14, listen what he says. If man dies, will he live again? Job asked that to the Lord. And the answer is, yes. The Bible, the Holy Word of God says yes, and we know in our hearts, we know even the people deny it, you know there's something more. Your spirit knows, because the Bible says you're made for eternity. We in our hearts know there's something more than this world. You see, the Bible teaches about life and death. The Bible has all the answers you will have. It's the only book that gives you hope for the future. God our Creator told us that we will die once, then we will face judgment. That is not the end, but simply that is a departure. See, there is life after death. That's why we have hope today. That's why we can cry. We should cry for missing a loved one, especially Felix, a man so amazing, a father to me, a friend. We should cry, but we can celebrate because we know he's in a better place. For the Christ follower, this departure brings great hope. Philippians 1:21 says, Paul says, the great apostle says, for me, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. It's amazing. Why? Because the Christian, Christ follower, is behind all the troubles, trials, suffering, sorrow, and disappointments behind. Do you know that Felix at this moment has a perfect body?
Yes.
Suited for heaven and for eternity. There is no more pain. There is no more for sorrow. There is no more illness. He don't get tired. He can drink all the coffee he wants. I think I had that. Today in heaven, Felix never looked better and felt better. And number three, death is a new beginning. Death really is a new beginning. For the Christ follower, for the Christian, there's only a beginning of eternal life with God. 2 Corinthians 5:1 says, now we know that as this early tent that we live is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal home in heaven, not built by human hands. Jesus tells us in John 14:1-3 says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I'm going to prepare a place for each of you. Verse 3. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so also you'll be there forever with me. So now, how long did it took Felix get to heaven? It was in an instant, in a second. I believe it's a blink of the eye. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That is not the end of life, but really it's a brand new beginning. It is an opportunity to move for an early tent, our body, this body that we have, into a heavenly mansion, one that is better, unending. One thing that we should all carefully consider, are we prepared for our death? Think about that. One thing about that, I'm not here to scare you, but when we come to a funeral, that's the reality of death. And sometimes people ask me, why did you share the gospel in the funeral? Because it's a time that we reflect in our life. It's a time that we say, you know what? What's going to happen to me and my loved ones? And we want to make sure that we go to the right place. Life is short, Life is short. The Bible warns you over and over. James 4:14 says, why do you not even know what will happen tomorrow? What is your life? You're a mist that appears for a little while and then vanish. Let us learn to a valuable lesson. Let us learn a valuable lesson. Let's appreciate life. Live each day with eternity in view. Let us learn to take time to enjoy one another, especially our spouse, our friends, and our family. That's the most important thing. People, our pastor used to say, people, time, and God. Work is not more important than your family. Felix teaches that. People are not more, your family is more important than anything. And God is just important because He loved you, He created you. And since we don't know when our appointment with death will come, the wisest thing to do is to be ready today. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. I'm sure if Felix were here right now, he can speak from heaven. He will say, what he will say? He will say something like this. Make sure if you that are here are going to heaven with me. I'm waiting for you. I'm sure he will say something like that. I think he will say, it's unbelievable here. It's amazing here. Bible says that no eyes have seen, no ears have heard, but the God has for those who love him. We think the earth is the land of the living, but really it's the land of the dead. We die every day more. Heaven is the land of the living. And I know that Felix will say, make sure that each of you go to heaven again. See, but going to heaven is not automatic. It's not because you're a good person or you do good things. If you ask, ask any pastor this year, how did Felix made it to heaven? Why he made it to heaven? That he did a lot of good things and made it to heaven? No. The answer is simple. Felix went to heaven because he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, personal Savior. Listen to one of the part or another, his favorite verse. Chapter says, the Lord is my shepherd. He made Jesus his personal shepherd. You must realize that Felix didn't went to heaven because he deserved it. He did a lot of good things, of course. He went to church. He took communion. He lived a good moral life. But all those things are not enough, and he knew that. The greatest deception in the entire world is that a good man and a woman can earn the way into heaven. Felix understood this, and he shared this with many people. I heard him sharing this with people that don't he didn't know that person, but he knew that person needed eternity. He shared the gospel. I learned so much about him and how to share the gospel of being a pastor from him, honestly. So what is the answer? What is the solution, what I'm presenting you today? Ephesians 2:8 and 9 says, for it's by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourself. It is the gift of God. Not by works, not by good works, things that we do good because we go to church or we are son of a pastor. So nobody can boast. But it's by the grace of God. The Bible tells us that each person is a sinner. We're all created to know God and be in a right relationship with Him. But our sin separates us from God. Second, this is why Jesus Christ went to the cross and died for our sins. The world right now says, don't mention the word sin. We're not trying to condemn anybody as a pastors or believers. We're just trying to tell you, you know what? It's a better place. One day you're going to face God. We love you. We just want to rescue you. We want to present the same message that one day somebody like Felix present us. There's the only way to get to heaven, and it's through Jesus Christ. Jesus said it. John 14:6 says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes through the Father except through me, says that. 5 seconds after that, everyone becomes a believer. But then, sad thing, it is too late. We must accept Jesus Christ when we are alive. The Bible gives us warnings constantly about that. See, you can live here today knowing that you're going to heaven, where Felix is. And let me tell you, he wants to see everyone here and there. I'd like to give an invitation at this moment. I know that Felix desire to make sure that you have an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as his memorial celebration of life. In a minute, I will ask you to bow your heads. And I won't pressure you. This is not to guilt you. This is just to encourage you to realize that your Heavenly Father, the one that created you, the one that knows you, wants you to spend eternity with him. I will never force you because God will never force nobody. That's why he gives you free will. You decide. You decide. But we encourage you to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and make sure that one day you die, you will go to heaven. Not because you're in it, it's because Jesus Christ paid for you. So please bow your heads. If you're serious about making this decision, I want to lead you in a prayer. And everybody has their head bowed, close your eyes. But if you're serious about that, just look at me for a second. And put your head down. And me, yeah. All the ones who do it. See? Yeah. Look at me. Put your head down. Perfect. Now in your breath, I want you to repeat this prayer. You're praying to the Lord. You're not praying to me. And your breath says, Heavenly Father, I realize that I'm a sinner. And I need a Savior because I have broken your commandments. As a result, I'm separated from you right now. I recognize that Jesus Christ came to this earth and died on the cross for all my sins, but has risen from the dead. Say to him in your breath, please forgive me for all my sins. I now repent of my old ways, and I want to follow Jesus and his word, the Bible. Please come into my life, Lord. I'd like to thank Kim, and I know she didn't want to say that, and Kevin. They really take care of Felix in the last days, and I saw that love from the family, and the family too that I met. We're honored, really honored. We really thank you. Thank you. And family, just an amazing family, an example.